Good morning, church, or good afternoon, good evening, good night. Whenever you're watching this, even if it's the next day, we are so happy that you are here to worship with our family at Campbell. I've been working a lot with the student ministry these past couple of months, and at every single small group, we ask everyone who's there. We go around in a circle, and on a scale from 1 to 10, ask, how are you doing emotionally, physically, and spiritually? Now, I want you in your head or with the people that are around you to do a little mental check-in and ask, how are you doing physically, emotionally, and spiritually? Now, wherever you are, I pray that you're well. I do want to pray that God meets you in the place that you're in this morning. So please join us as we worship together.
Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history you lived and died. You broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we Jesus, hope of the nations, Jesus, comfort for all who mourn. You are the source of heaven's hope on earth. Jesus, light in the darkness, Jesus, truth in each circumstance. You are the source of heaven's light on earth. In history you lived and died. You broke the chains, you rose to life. You are the hope living in us. You are the rock in whom we trust. You are the light shining for all the world to see. You rose from the dead, conquering fear. Our Prince of Peace, drawing us near. Jesus, our hope, living for all who will receive. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe. Lord, we believe.
This has been such an unusual year for me. I've never experienced a year where so many things were so different and unsettled. It's kind of uncharted territory for me, and sometimes I don't know what to think about it. And in times like this, I find myself finding comfort in some of the passages that help me rely on God. Here's a good one for today, Psalm 9:7. The Lord reigns forever. He has established his throne for judgment. He will judge the world in righteousness. He will govern the peoples with justice. The Lord is a refuge for the oppressed, a stronghold in time of trouble. Those who know your name will trust in you, for you, Lord, have never forsaken those who seek you. Let's pray. Father God, I just come before you right now, Father, lifting up our prayers to you. Father, you are the great God, and you are the creator of the universe, but you created us to have relationship with you. You know each one of us, and you love each one of us. Father, I just thank you for all you've done for us. Thank you for the life we have, and especially for this church, that where believers and you come together to worship together and serve together and work together to make this world what you want it to be. Father, I know this has been such a strange time, and there's so many weird things going on in the world. And Father, I know the world is a broken place, and it's not what you had intended for this world to be. Sin entered, and Satan is trying to attack us constantly. But Father, we know that you have a better place prepared for us. God, I just thank you that you are there for us, that you never forsake us, that you are there to provide refuge and comfort and peace during such unusual times. God, keep each one of us close to you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain, that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on toward love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. Here is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, when Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid. Here in the death of Christ I live. There in the ground his body lay. Light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands for victory, sin's curse has lost its grip on me. For I am his, and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of Christ. No guilt in life, no fear in death, this This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand.
Well, good morning, Campbell family. You might recall back on June the 7th of this year, the elders, ministers, and church staff made a statement expressing that we were sorry. And when we said we're sorry, we meant it. We were and are sorry for the racial injustice and disharmony many in our church and our culture must deal with. We told you that though we do not have all the answers, we recognized that inaction is not an option. We told you that we plan to listen and seek to understand how we as a body of Christ can respond to racism and all injustices that grieve the heart of God. For the last month, we've done just that. As we continue this journey, we would like to tell you about one of the next steps for the Campbell Church. The elders and the church staff wish to call forth a group of faithful brothers and sisters to help us all learn, grow, and faithfully act to heal the wounds of racial and social injustice. Now, the mission of this group, which we are calling the Diversity and Inclusion Advisory Team, is to encourage, guide, and educate the Campbell Church to promote a culturally sensitive, welcoming, and inclusive environment in the spirit of Galatians 3:28, which says, "There is neither Jew or Gentile, neither slave nor free, nor is there male and female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus." Now, the goals of this group are to, first of all, provide staff, elders, and the congregation with resources for personal and corporate growth, promoting inclusion, participation, and community across ethnicity, gender, and class. Secondly, to act as an agency of advice and counsel to Campbell leadership when cultural conditions warrant the response from the church. And finally, to act in a manner which promotes church unity and the spirit of witness. You'll hear more about this team and their mission in the days to come. We ask all the church to join us in a prayer of blessings on this team and this church as we seek to learn, grow, and heal the wounds of social injustice. Just want to leave you with a scripture that's guiding our hearts from 2 Chronicles chapter 20, verse 12. "Lord, we do not know what to do, but our eyes are on you." Thank you for listening, and God bless.
In this world, there is birth and death. There is planting and uprooting. There is killing and healing, building and demolishing, weeping and laughing, mourning and dancing, gathering and scattering, searching and giving up the search, keeping and discarding, tearing and mending, speaking and listening, loving and hating, making war, making peace, embracing, and social distancing. In this broken world, one crisis stacks itself upon another. In this fallen world, one frustration compounds another. Frustration over right and wrong, action and inaction, progress and setback. In this broken world, Jesus calls to us through the crisis. Jesus calls to us through the frustration and says, "Do this in remembrance of me." Remembrance of what? Paul says, "Thank God, who gives us victory through our Lord Jesus Christ." Victory over crisis, victory over brokenness, victory over frustration, victory over sin. So take bread, drink wine, and remember Jesus. Remember his blood, remember his pain, remember his victory. In your time of frustration, remember that there is one who has already achieved victory over the crises of this world. There is one who has already redeemed the broken things of this world. Remember him. And just as you would draw strength from good food, draw strength from Jesus. Dear God, we are thankful for the bread that you give us daily. We are thankful for the strength that you give us daily through your victory over the brokenness and sin of this world. We take bread now, we remember you, and we thank you. In your name we pray, amen. Dear God, we thank you for the cup. We thank you for the wine. We thank you for your pain, for your blood, and for your suffering. We thank you for your grace. May we remember it every moment, every day of our lives, that your victory has already been won. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, everyone. JD here. I hope you're all doing well and navigating through this difficult time successfully. I have a confession I need to make to everybody. My giving for the church has fallen off significantly. Now, I can explain that. The reason why it's fallen off is because I have not made as much money. My businesses have been wanting this year, and I can say that's the reason, and perhaps there's some truth to that. And I could also say perhaps my reason for not giving is fear. Fear that because I'm not making as much money, I need to have more monies in my reserves. Regardless, I've broken my normal philosophy, which is give first and trust God later, so to speak. The point is, I think I've lost my trust in God a little bit. You know, with all the things that are happening, all the difficulties, I think I may have lost my trust a little bit, because if I truly trust God, and I'm speaking for myself here, if I truly trust God, then I should be able to still give, and then he can provide. And here's the interesting thing. Even though I think I've lost a little bit of my trust in God as a result of all the scary things that are happening, I believe God has not lost his trust in me. And the blessing is he's provided for me. He's given me some wonderful contracts and things so that I can make money. And so that's an important lesson. Even when we lose trust, God does not lose trust. God continues to be who he is. And I feel blessed beyond imagination. And I know that these blessings have come from God because it's not due to anything I did because of my marketing or any of the other business things I tried to accomplish. You know, I prayed and the Lord has provided. And so now I want to remember, give first and trust God. And I hope that that's helpful to some of you as you navigate through this difficult time. So now let's go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, thank you for all the wonderful blessings you give us and all the things you do for us and the fact that you continue to trust us even when we lose faith or lose our trust, and help us to gain that trust back and remember you and to think positive things and still give. And not just of our financial means, but also of our time. And Lord, we're so very fortunate for all that you've done, and we're very thankful for, again, for all the blessings you've given us, but mostly we're thankful for your Son, and we submit this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, and enjoy the rest of your day.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder? Who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Our chaos back into order, who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you would lay down your life, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Hey everyone, well, it's exciting to introduce our guest speaker this morning because he's somebody that's very familiar to us. At least he should be. He just left, I think, several months ago to answer a call to Montana. You might know who I'm talking about. Yes, it's our very own Scott Falkowski. And it's just so glad to hear his voice again this morning. He's going to bring a message to us that I'm sure is going to impact our lives and our hearts. So, here's Scott.
Good morning, Campbell Church. How are y'all doing today? It is such an honor and a blessing for me to share with you today. It's pretty cool, isn't it? At least for me, and maybe a little surreal as well. But having Shane preach last week, and then I'm honored with this opportunity to share with you today, just brought back a lot of great memories for me. I want to say hello from South Hills Church of Christ. This is a picture of the Gates of the Mountains, which is just up the road from us. Site of Lewis and Clark's probably most disappointing time on their trip, as this is where they realized they still had a lot more to go on their journey. But South Hills Church of Christ says hello, as do Annette and Jarrett and Bryce. They send their greetings. And they hope that you're all well and staying healthy and being blessed. And so today we are going to talk about, you ready for that? Sodom and Gomorrah, Genesis chapter 18 and 19. Sodom and Gomorrah, and I want to focus on the draw of sin. And I'm sure you're like, well, wait a second. Sin? Come on, Scott, is that really where you want to go today? Well, this is what I've been studying while I've been out here. And it just is a passage that I think is very important for all of us to look at and think about, because there is a pretty strong draw to that sinful nature, that old self, that past, if you will, that we're to leave behind as we move towards the kingdom. And so before we get to Sodom and Gomorrah specifically, just some kind of foundational pieces is what's gone on in Genesis. Abraham has become the star of the story, as in Genesis 12, where he receives some promises from God, some blessings from God, some pretty amazing things, where he steps out in faith, and God says, all right, here's the deal, you've stepped out, and this is all yours. But the one thing that really stands out to me, even though he is a hero of faith, and he is one of the great heroes of the Old Testament, he was a pretty flawed individual, which gives me some comfort that I too am flawed, but I know that God loves me. And that's Abraham. He's flawed. He receives these promises, these blessings, and even the great covenant from God. But yet you see him taking matters into his own hands. And when a famine hits, he heads down to Egypt without consulting God. Or a couple of times he actually lies about Sarah, his wife, in order that things would work out better for himself. And so, sure, he has some flaws. I mean, as all human beings do, even all of the heroes that are listed in Hebrews that look back on the Old Testament, except for Jesus, who was perfect, they're all flawed, and all their faithfulness and all the good things they accomplish, like Abraham accomplishes, they just point us towards Jesus. That's what the whole Old Testament is about. And so Abe is the hero, but we are going to talk about some other people too. But Hebrews tells us, by faith, Abraham, when called to go to a place he would later receive as his inheritance, obeyed and went, even though he did not know where he was going. And so that's Abe. That's the New Testament's perspective on him. But I want to shift a little bit over to his nephew Lot. So Lot followed Abraham back in Genesis 12 when they left their place up in Ur and headed down with him. And in addition to God blessing Abraham, God has also blessed Lot to the point where they each have so many flocks and so many servants that there starts to be some arguments and they split. And so Abraham doesn't have to do this, but this is just a sign of, he knows God's going to take care of him. So he says, hey, Lot, you get to choose where you want to go. You go that way, I'll go the opposite way. No more fighting, all is good. And so this is where we start talking about the draw of sin. Because here's what Lot does. It says, Lot sees this amazing place. I mean, it kind of is Santa Clara Valley, just lush and open and full of opportunity for growing things. And he says, that's where I want to go. My flocks are going to flourish out there. So he heads out there. And in Genesis 13, it tells us he pitched his tents near Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay? So we start to see this progression. He's near Sodom and Gomorrah. The next chapter, he's actually living in Sodom and Gomorrah. Abram actually has to go in and bring his army, and because Lot's been taken captive, and so he defeats that army, takes Lot back, and Lot heads back into Sodom and Gomorrah. So he's gone from being outside, now being inside, and not only that, we'll see in our story today, he's actually sitting at the city gate. And so what does that mean? So his place at the gate, so at the gate is where all of the wise men, the noblemen, the people of importance would hang out, because they would get information from people who are coming in to trade goods. It's also the place where even judgments will be made and a court will occur. And so he's gone in a few short chapters from being outside of Sodom and Gomorrah to actually being really fully enmeshed in the society that's there. And so I titled this The Draw of Sin. And anytime I think about this, I'm always reminded of this clip from Bug's Life.
No, hurry, no! Don't look at the light!
I can't help it. It's so beautiful.
Holden, that's one's for you. Hope you enjoyed it. But that whole clip, as we look at sin and the draw of sin, it causes me to ask the question, what is it about sin? What is it that is so enticing that in like this short clip, you know, the bug zapper, they know it's gonna mean demise for the bug as it heads towards it, and he's got a friend warning him, but yet it's so beautiful, I'm drawn towards it, and then ultimately falls into the dumpster. And so what is it about sin? What is that draw? We look way back in Genesis 3. When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some of it and ate. So sin can have a look to it that really entices us, causes us to desire it. But here's the deal. We as believers, we know that God's ways are much better. But yet, me, I continue to get drawn into sin. We know God's ways are much better. The psalmist just puts it in such wonderful terms. You know, everyone knows this particular Psalm 23. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He allows me to get to a place where I can just sit back, have peace and joy in him, and my soul is restored. Or this one from the Psalms as well. You make known to me the path of life. Life, isn't that what we all desire? Life worth living, life to its fullest. You fill me with joy in your presence, with eternal pleasures at your right hand. So there's this draw of sin, this draw of, I'll say, the past or other things out there that we know we shouldn't go down that path because we know that God's ways are better. But unfortunately, there is evil in this world and Satan is at work. And unfortunately, sin has a tremendous draw. But we have something greater than sin residing in us, and that's the Holy Spirit. But I want to look at a couple of quotes from some pretty famous Christian authors. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, this wonderful preacher who preached out against Nazi Germany, and he was put into prison. He said this about sin. When all is said and done, the life of faith is nothing if not an unending struggle of the spirit with every available weapon against the flesh meaning sinful nature, as opposed to our spiritual nature, Holy Spirit, sinful nature. And then Timothy Keller, who's a modern day scholar, he says the gospel is this: we are more sinful and flawed in ourselves than we ever dared believe. Yet at the very same time, we're more loved and accepted in Jesus Christ than we ever dared hope. Amen. And that's the thing. Even though it can be difficult and there's such a draw of sin, we have the power through the Holy Spirit, through Jesus, so that there is hope to live a life of kingdom focus. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this opportunity to share with my friends at the Campbell Church. I do miss them, and I wish them well. Lord, as we talk about sin, a difficult subject, no doubt, I pray that you use my words and that your scripture comes to life, and that we are all charged and encouraged and grow closer to you through this study. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's dig into our text. Genesis 18 and 19 is where we're going to land today. And so early on in Genesis 18, so remember, Abraham has been promised a couple of different times that he is going to have a child through Sarah, and that from that child is going to become a great nation, and that that nation and that his offspring are going to bless the entire world. And so in the beginning of 18, we have three visitors show up to the camp where Abraham and Sarah are. And so these three visitors, two of them are mentioned as angelic beings, and the third one is referred to as the angel of the Lord. Scholars believe that whenever the angel of the Lord is mentioned in the Old Testament, that it's actually the pre-incarnate Jesus showing up on earth. And so you've got these three amazing visitors come. Abraham recognizes these three people are special. He sets up a great feast for them, offers them shade, water to wash their feet from the journey, and then they start to eat, and he just sits there. And then one of the angel of the Lord says, hey, next year, I want to get specific with those promises. Sarah is going to have a baby. So Sarah's is 89 at this point. She's going to be 90. Abraham's going to be 100. And so now the promise is getting specific. It had been 24 years that they had waited until this time to get this specific promise. That's one of the reasons why we say Abraham is such a man of faith, because he continued to press on and believe in spite of his old age and the promises that God had told him. And so we go from those visitors to this interesting, there's some back and forth that happens. So the two angelic visitors decide it's time to head back down. And so the angel of the Lord has a conversation with Abraham. And he says, the outcry against Sodom and Gomorrah is so great and their sin so grievous that I will go down and see if it is that bad. I want to see for myself how bad things have gotten. And so, outcry. We don't quite know who has sent that outcry to the Lord. It actually could have been Abraham. We don't know. We find out that there's no righteous people in Sodom and Gomorrah, so it's probably not from any humans there. What's really interesting is archaeological digs lead us to believe that there's about 30,000 people living in Sodom and Gomorrah at the time of this story. So that's pretty big cities for a few thousand years ago. And so this outcry, we see in scripture at times where the stones will cry out or the creation is groaning. And so just as the blood of Abel outcried or cried up to God, that's kind of the imagery we have here. It's just so bad that it reaches the heavens, it reaches God. But God does an interesting thing. He wants to come down for himself. And so verse 22, the men turned away and went down towards Sodom, but Abraham remained standing before the Lord. So he's going to be in an interesting place, okay? So God has sent these messengers to state, this is what I want to do, but I need to check it out for myself. And I'm sure Abraham's a bit, what? Really? You know, wow, okay. Thanks for telling me. And he's just kind of in awe, but he stands there next to the angel of the Lord. So as we continue on, so what is that sin? Ezekiel says that Sodom and Gomorrah, they were terrible about taking care of the widows and the orphans. That's actually a theme that comes through the prophets of the Old Testament a lot, that Israel and Judah neglected the poor, neglected those who needed to be taken care of. So Ezekiel tells us, now this was the sin of your sister Sodom. She and her daughters were arrogant, overfed, and unconcerned. They did not help the poor and needy. They were haughty and did detestable things before me. Therefore, I did away with them as you have seen. So it's pretty bad. I mean, it's just dog eat dog, people abusing people, and just a very violent, horrible, sinful situation. So that's Sodom and Gomorrah. And so Abraham is going to get pretty bold here. So he's standing with the angel of the Lord as the two angels head down. And he says in verse 23, Abraham approached him and said, "Will you sweep away the righteous with the wicked?" And so Abraham's going to start this pleading, if you will, because he knows Lot and his family are down there in Sodom and Gomorrah, and he doesn't want them destroyed. Abraham knows the cities are sinful. He never, at least in Scripture, goes down there. I'm sure he laments the fact that Lot has chosen to enter the city and be a part of this difficult place. And so, but on the other hand, Abraham's like, wait a second, would you really destroy a place? What happens if there's good people down there? So Abraham starts to negotiate. It's one of those difficult passages, if you will, where people ask, can you change God's mind? If you negotiate, will God alter his plans and things like that? And so we see that here. We'll see that a little later in Moses with regards to Israel, when God wanted to destroy Israel because of their sin. And so Abraham starts pleading and says, hey, look, God, if there's 50 righteous people, remember out of 30,000, if there's 50 righteous people, are you really going to destroy the city? Hey, that wouldn't look very good. And God says, you're right. If there's 50 people, I'm not going to destroy the city. And then Abraham gets kind of bold. Okay, what happens if there's 5 less? 45. What happens if there's 40? God says, sure, I will not destroy the city if we can find 40, 30, 20, 10 righteous people out of 30,000. And so God says, yep, okay, if I find 10, I will not destroy the city. I'll leave it. That's all good, okay? So as the angels head down to make their count, find out who's righteous down there, Abraham, as we'll see, is anxiously watching what's going to go on in the city, what's going to happen to Lot and his family. And so that takes us to Genesis 19. And this is really a tough story. It's really a difficult one to deal with. We will keep it at the GPG level because the point isn't what sin it was. The point was that it was a very sinful place and was just going down the wrong road. So here we go. Remember, we have Lot who sits at the gate. Okay, so he's in that special place. In chapter 19, verse 1, they enter. The two angels arrived at Sodom in the evening, and Lot was sitting in the gateway of the city. When he saw them, he got up to meet them and bowed down with his face to the ground. My lords, he said, please turn aside to your servant's house. You can wash your feet, spend the night, and then go on your way early in the morning. I mean, here's the one thing we know. Lot understands the people around him and understands that he's living in a terrible place. Lot wants to save these men. Hey, let's just go right from here into my house. I'll take care of you, and then you can head on your way. He doesn't want anything to happen to them. That's part of the hospitality nature of the Middle Eastern culture. But he also knows this is not a safe place to be, especially at night. But the angels are, no, we're actually going to go walk through, see what's going on. We need to do our mission. And then Lot pleads with them and says, no, please, please, come in. You know, we'll make a meal. Like I said, we'll give you water. And so they say, okay, sure, we'll go with you. Lead us to your house. So they get to his house and they're having this feast. It's kind of like what Abraham did as well. I'll give you water to wash your feet. I'll bake you some bread. But in this case, it's interesting. It's unleavened bread so they can get moving quickly if they have to. And so at some point, there's a big ruckus outside of the house, and Lot has to confront this mob, this crowd that's outside. And so that's not going very well. And the angels actually reach outside the door, pick Lot by the arm, drag him back inside, close the door, and then give a plague of blindness to those who are out there. And so they're all, oh no, discombobulated, can't figure out what's going on. And so for the evening, the group is safe. So as we continue with the story, up to verse 15. Now notice the language that's used here. And once again, that draw of sin that sucks you in, and you know, you kind of start to put roots in a place like that, like Lot has, and it's not a healthy place. And so it says, with the coming of the dawn, the angels urged Lot, saying, hurry, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, or you'll be swept away when the city is punished. They had told Lot, you know, we have to destroy this place. It's not a good place. It's not a healthy place. The outcry is too great. And so Lot knew that, but yet they still have to urge him, hurry, let's get out of here. Let's get your family to safety. He hesitated. Verse 16, when he hesitated, the man grasped his hand and the hands of his wife and his two daughters and led them safely out of the city, for the Lord was merciful to them. I mean, here's one of the things that we have to think about. The draw of sin can cause us to lose everything. It can cause us to lose our perspective, our understanding. Lot's had some interaction with God, just like Abraham has. Lot has heard the stories. Lot has seen God take care of Abraham, but he has lost the perspective. I mean, why would you have teenage daughters living in a violent, horrible, sinful situation like this? He's just lost his perspective. The draw of sin can actually cause us to lose even our own life. It can cause us to go down a road towards destruction, as the Gospels and the Old Testament tell us. But here's the deal. You are never a lost cause. We are never a lost cause, because while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Amen to that. And so, we continue on with the story. Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed. Sulfur is rained down on them from the Lord out of the heavens. Thus, he overthrew those cities and the entire plain, destroying all those living in the cities, and also the vegetation of the land. Now, before this, there's a little kind of back and forth between the two messengers, the two angels, and Lot. And Lot says, hey, I want to head over to that small city. You know, I don't want to go up to the mountains because I know that might be safe, but I can't get there quickly, and I'm worried about what you're going to do. And so he heads off to the city, and the messengers say, here's the deal. Don't look back. You know, and don't, you know, look back into that, you know, what's drawn you towards there. Don't look back at what's happening. You need to stay focused, go forward, keep your mind on the good. Keep your mind on God in this situation. And so it's interesting because the author Luke uses this particular event, because as it says at the end here, but Lot's wife looked back and she became a pillar of salt. So Luke says, it will be just like this on the day of the Son of Man is revealed. On that day, no one who is on the housetop with possessions inside should go down to get them. Likewise, no one in the field should go back for anything. Remember Lot's wife? Whoever tries to keep their life will lose it, and whoever loses their life will preserve it. So in other words, whoever continues to hold on to, have an anchor into that world of sin, you're going to lose your life. Instead, when the kingdom has come to you, when salvation has come to you, when you have made the Lord, your King, and you have the Holy Spirit within you, you need to focus ahead. And we can do that with the power of the Holy Spirit. We can have that proper perspective and not be drawn towards the stuff that's behind us. Now understand, we need to know our history. There's no doubt about it. Where did I come from? That's part of my testimony. I was this without Christ. Now I am this example, this ambassador, this witness, sharing the gospel with others through my words and my deeds. And so an interesting statement comes at the end here. And unfortunately, we get the understanding that Lot is not the hero of this story. Yes, Lot is saved by God, but the reason why Lot is saved is because of Abraham. As 29 tells us, so when God destroyed the cities of the plain, he remembered Abraham and he brought Lot out of the catastrophe that overthrew the cities where Lot had lived. So understand this, your prayers on behalf of another, your petitions on behalf of another, your requests on behalf of another, your encouragement to another, that doesn't fall on deaf ears. It makes a difference. You may not see it now, you may not see it in 10 years, but God hears it. God hears the outcry. God hears the outcries that are happening all around our nation right now, and he is listening. I mean, think about this. Did God, the creator of the universe, who's going to bring down fire on Sodom and Gomorrah, have to come down and talk to Abraham and tell him what he was going to do? God's the judge. But God desires a relationship with us, just like he did with Abraham. Hey, Abraham, here's what I'm going to do. I mean, he didn't say, what do you think? But that's kind of what's going on here, because he allowed Abraham the opportunity to share his thoughts. God wants a relationship with you. God loves you and cares for you and wants to hear from you. And so earlier, we talked about, you know, do not love the world or anything in the world. If anyone loves the world, love for the Father is not in them. We can't love the world. We can't hang on to that. Our focus needs to be on the kingdom to come. And so I said that we could lose our perspective with sin. And that seems to be what has happened with Lot. I mean, think about this. Sodom and Gomorrah through Lot's eyes. Oh, it's a place for me to gain some power, authority, or place, if you will. Kind of drawn into that with losing the perspective of what's going on around. Abraham, he has a perspective of Sodom and Gomorrah so that he's stayed away from it. He knows it's not good, but he still has a human perspective about it. Do you really want to destroy that place, God? Are you sure you're making the right choice? But how about Sodom and Gomorrah and sin from God's perspective? God knows that sin can just rip us apart. I mean, think about our brothers and sisters who are in addiction, who have had those types of struggles, pornography, narcotics, whatever it may be. Sin can just take hold and just ruin the soul, ruin the heart. Remember, the psalmist said, you restore my soul. A life of a kingdom believer, a spirit-filled believer, your soul is restored. God's perspective on the world around us. Do we have that perspective of those around us? Are we paying attention to those around us who are in need? I love what Campbell does with the care ministry every other Saturday. What a blessing that you have that pantry, that partnership with City Team, so that you can bless those who need it. Praise God. Keep it going. God loves that. That's part of his perspective of the world around us. And so think about your own life through your eyes. I don't want to be like this guilt person here, but, you know, are you living every aspect of your life as God would want it? What does God see when he looks at your life? Remember, if you are a believer, God sees you as a son and daughter. Amen to that. You are adopted into his family. And so, just a couple of thoughts as I close. May we learn to see ourselves in the world through God's eyes. And that's a continuous process. No matter if you've been a believer for decades or you're just a new believer, we all need to work on seeing the world around us and understanding and having spiritual wisdom to see it through God's eyes. The God of the universe desires to hear from us and values our thoughts and views. Like I said, he didn't have to enter into the world to talk to Abraham about what he was going to do. Nor did he have to send his son into the world, into our timeline. But he did. Because he loves us and he values us. But we do not fully understand God's ways and why he would judge in such a way, like Noah's flood or this particular instance, why there would have to be this destruction. And unfortunately, I have to trust him, the creator, the king. Make sure you're walking with someone who can help draw you towards the kingdom. And so maybe that's another flaw of Abraham. It doesn't say in the text that he goes down and tries to get Lot out of Sodom and Gomorrah. And it sure appears that Lot doesn't have another righteous person to encourage him out of that as he's lost his perspective. We can't do it alone. Yes, okay, yes, the Holy Spirit can do miraculous things in the individual, but the Christian walk is meant to be lived hand in hand, together, so we can encourage each other and hold each other accountable. And lastly, sin does not have victory over us. Praise Jesus. Jesus Christ conquered sin and death. And he reigns in heaven, and his kingdom is here, and his kingdom is to come. Be that kingdom citizen who focuses on kingdom work, serving Jesus, serving others. Love God, love others. Thanks for this opportunity, Campbell. I hope you have a blessed rest of your day. Let me pray for you. God, thanks for this chance. Lord, we know that sin can be a powerful draw on us. And I just pray that your Holy Spirit fills us just in a mighty way so that we can continue to do your work in Campbell, California, Helena, Montana, and wherever believers are. May your kingdom be known. May your peace surround us and fill us. In Jesus' name, amen. Bye.
Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change, one thing remains. Higher than the mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change, one thing remains, one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love, your love, and on and on it goes, and it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. I never, ever have to be afraid. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Never fails and never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love, your love, in death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your great love. My debt is paid, there's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love. Satisfies my soul.
gives up. It never runs out on me.
Scott, thank you so much for your message this morning. I want to come back to that mental check-in, how you were doing physically, emotionally, and spiritually. In this season, I have been reminded that we are built for community. And right now, when community isn't as accessible as we'd like it to be, I want to encourage you to reach out to a family member or a friend or someone in the church or even someone down on that little prayer button at the bottom of the screen. And ask them and share with them how you're doing and how they're doing physically, emotionally, and spiritually. Again, wherever you are, I pray that God meets you in the rest of this week and in today. You are loved. Go in peace.